In a previous video, I covered Streamlit, a system for quickly creating web GUIs as frontends for Python apps, mainly for data science. And while Streamlit is a powerful and useful tool, it's also got its fair share of quirks and detractors. For some folks, writing Streamlit apps feels counterintuitive and overly complicated. But Streamlit is far from the only way to write Python apps with web GUI frontends. In this video, I'm going to take a look at NiceGUI, another framework for writing such interfaces. It generates good-looking UIs, it supports a wide range of web features, and its code is a little less awkward to work with than Streamlit. So let's take a look at some simple examples, and also some fairly sophisticated ones too. Let's begin with your standard Hello World app. This creates a web page with a text label, Hello World, and a button that when clicked shows a brief pop-up notification. Now if we run this, it's going to take a moment for NiceGUI to bind everything together and to start the app. But once it's ready, we have an interactive web page. And when we click the button, we can see a notification appear briefly. Now notice how we have done all of this without writing a single line of HTML or JS or CSS. You can use those things more directly in NiceGUI if you want for more precise effects, but you don't need them for basic functionality. NiceGUI uses the Tailwind CSS framework and the Quasar component system, for those of you who are familiar with the technologies in question. Quasar uses the Google Material UI guidelines and is itself based on Vue.js. So it has roots in existing frameworks with a fair level of support for them. Now here's an example that shows some common interface elements and how they are implemented. And there are two things worth talking about here. One of them is you can see closer here the way we can bind actions of elements to a function like show, or we could use a lambda for a simple event trigger, depending on how much we want to accomplish. The other thing to point out is the way we are using Python's context managers, the with keyword, to create elements that are going to have children inserted into them. For instance, when we see with UI.row, that creates a new table row, and in the context of this block, everything that we add is going to be created as a child element for that row. So this makes it easier to programmatically generate nested layouts of the kind that you find very often in HTML source code. So if we run this, we will see a slew of different controls, all of which behave as we expect them to, all of which we can get results from for our backend, and again, with all of those behaviors provided through Python. Let's take a look at another example where there's some other kinds of interactivity being demonstrated. Here we have a type to search box, which queries an online database of mixed drinks. And down here, we create the search field, which is a named object, so we can refer back to it and do things with it later. And we do the same thing with the results row on the page. This row is at first empty, so we'll later want to add things to it and then clear it out completely. So we make it into a named object also. Now the input field has a function wired to it, an async function, and that fires when we type something in. So when this function's called, the first thing it does is it cancels any existing queries, clears out existing searches from that row that I mentioned before. It launches the query asynchronously, so it doesn't block any other behavior, and then adds any of the results returned from the query to the results row as new elements. So when we run this, you'll see that we get a search field, and we can type into that search field and have the results show up automatically. And again, the vast majority of the heavy lifting that we'd need to do to create something like this, we've done it in just a few lines of Python. Now, I should point out this program has a few things that require some awareness of JavaScript and CSS. The styling and the properties that we add to elements, for instance, those are all declared manually in some of these examples. And the names of the events and some of the object classes, like the argument E for the search function or the on event names, those are all things you need to have at least passing awareness of because they do all come from the JavaScript side of things. On the plus side, they're well documented and they're not difficult to reverse engineer from the many examples in the NiceGUI repository. To that end, my feeling is the best way to get some footing with NiceGUI and to see if it suits your needs is to grab some of the examples in the repository and give them a spin. Many of those examples support fairly advanced browser functions, like opening a local file picker, or recording or playing audio, or using the web serial API. Odds are, if you have a project in mind, you can find an example that gives you a base to build on, and you can get an idea if NiceGUI suits you for it. So that's it for this episode. If you liked it, leave a comment below. And don't forget to follow Dev with Sirdar and InfoWorld on Facebook, YouTube, and InfoWorld.com.